Tonight, your name is written in the Lamb's book of life. If it had not been for the Lord on our side. So Lord, we thank you tonight, Lord, that you have forgiven all of our sins. Lord, your mercy is as high as the planet Jupiter is from the Legacy Center. That's how high your mercy is tonight over our lives. And Lord, you heal every disease. Lord, you fill our mouth with good things. We're going to receive the word of God. We're going to receive a prayer anointing like Jeremiah prayed. Lord, you're raising up men and women in this conference, oh God. Lord, that are going to experience a new dimension, God, a new level, Lord, of strategic spiritual warfare prayer. Lord, we thank you for Morris and Teresa Cerullo, Lord, and their burden for prayer. It was that burden that built this miracle that we're standing in the middle of tonight. And Lord, we have come together tonight, all day tomorrow, with the same question that the disciples asked you. They didn't say, Lord, teach me to prosper, teach me to heal, teach me to preach. But they said, Lord, if you will teach me how to pray like you pray, then your prosperity, your miracles, your anointing will increase upon my life. Somebody go ahead and give the Lord a mighty hand clap of praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, turn to at least two people and tell them, did you know you have more power than the devil? Amen. And then you may be seated. I need a card with the book on it. It's not. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. All right, you may be seated in his presence. We are going to do something so exciting. I cannot wait. But I'm so glad that our dear friend, Dr. Larry Lee and Leah are in the house. Come on, give them a good San Diego welcome. Come on. This is a man that Oral Roberts, Dr. Morris Cerullo called an apostle of prayer to this generation. It is a dream for you to be here. I don't know why we waited this long, but you know, sometimes like Morris said, the key to spiritual breakthrough is timing. And I believe that this is an incredible time. And we want to first of all thank you for coming tonight, and the Lord is so pleased. You know, when you call a conference on miracles, when you call a conference on financial blessing, or you call a conference on you kind of fill in the blank, it's one thing. But you know, when you call a conference, Lord, teach us to pray. I tell you what, it's a special group of people that are here tonight. You know, it wasn't the masses that Jesus taught how to pray. It was the ones that wanted to be near him, that wanted to be like him, that wanted to be what he said they could be. You know, the greatest battle over your life is what you believe about God and what you believe God believes about you. And I want you to know something. We're going to hear tonight a voice, the voice of the intercessor, praying for us tonight. I guarantee you, Jesus, even while Larry Lee is preaching tonight, while Brian Bauer is leading us in worship tonight, while you're worshiping, I want you to know something. Jesus is praying for you. We're going to believe him for miracles. We didn't just come here to learn how to pray, but we came here to pray. We came here to see God do something. He said, if you will call upon me, he just said, ask, you will receive. And how many of you know, Jesus said, when you pray, pray like this. And, you know, the Bible says that the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man. So if there's effectual prayer, there's ineffectual prayer. And we're going to learn to pray like Jesus wants us to pray, and we're going to get the results that Jesus wants us to have. Bishop McClendon is in the house, and the incredible family. Give them a good God bless you. And so, number one, you should have received, we have a gift. You have to have this, and it is free. And somebody say free is good. This is a $10 value. This is Dr. Cerullo's 300-page, it's the secret of his ministry, and it is Lord Teach Us to Pray, and it is his prayer classic. It's 7 decades of prayer secrets from the life of Dr. Morris Cerullo, and there are great quotes throughout this book from some of the great men and women of God that have been used down through the ages to birth incredible answers to prayer. And so we want to make sure you've got this. Use the QR code. If there was one thing we learned in COVID, at least one thing I learned, was how to work a QR code. All right, so I don't think there's anybody that doesn't know what to do. But in case you don't, you just put your camera on this funny-looking box, and it's going to take you to a website. You just click on it, and you're going to have, boom, 300 pages, Lord Teach Us to Pray, in your phone. And if you didn't get one of these, make sure you get one. They're on the registration desk. And it is a precious, precious gift. I miss him so very much. Dr. Cerullo wasn't just somebody that talked about prayer, but this was a man that lived in the presence of God. And if there's anybody that you could learn from, I love Dr. Larry Lee, but I think he would be the first one to tell you that Dr. Cerullo was an apostle of prayer, and he was an incredible man of prayer. This place would never have been built if it wasn't for a man and a woman by the name of Morris and Teresa Cerullo that believe God in the place of prayer. And what a miracle that we're sitting in tonight. How many of you are glad to be at your Legacy International Center, debt-free, which is another miracle? You know, Dr. Cerullo said 3 things to us. He said about 15 years ago, he said, God spoke to me and said, build me, meaning God, a legacy center. I want you to know something. This place is not a monument to Morris and Teresa Cerullo, but it's a monument to the Lord God of Morris and Teresa Cerullo. And it's a monument to the God that answers prayer. It's the monument to a God that could take a boy who at the age of 2 lost both of his parents, was raised in a Jewish Orthodox orphanage, was taken into the heavens, saw the glory of God, and gave his life to the ministry. And for 7 decades, God used him in an incredible way. And God said to Morris, build me a legacy center. Then he said, number 2, he said, I'm going to help you to build it debt-free. 2 weeks before Brother Cerullo went home to be with the Lord, he was in our little apartment. We were having a very, very precious time of dinner together. And he sat there on our sofa and he said, Greg, I'm having Lynn Hodge, who was our CEO at that time, prepare a report. I still don't know where all of the finances came from that paid for this place, but it has been built just like the Lord said, debt-free, over $200 million. You're sitting in the middle of a miracle. And this is not a ministry with a $200 million budget. How many of you know that the anointing that you connect with is the anointing that you receive from? So if you need God to do something, if your dream is bigger than your budget, then you're in the right place. And so then the Lord said, the third thing he said, and this was always the thing we would say, oh no, but he would say, God said, build me a legacy center. I'm gonna help you build it debt free. And then once it's finished, I'm taking you home. And we used to say, MC, we're gonna build this place. We can do it debt free, but we need you. You're not going anywhere. He said, this place will not be here for a year and I'll be gone. And I'm here tonight to tell you that anointings never leave the earth. I want you to know Morris Cerullo doesn't need his anointing anymore. Anointings either lie dormant, or if you pick them up, they intensify. And I believe that every one of you that are here tonight, you're here to pick up a double portion. How many of you say, I'm ready for the double portion tonight? And so I just want to encourage you, just set aside your Saturday, tomorrow morning. What a power-packed day we have tomorrow. Bishop McClendon is in the house. He's going to be bringing, there's nobody that preaches the word. I love the word, the prophetic word. And our dear pastor, Al, I love you so much. Al Valdez from Victory Outreach, one of the great churches in San Diego. And then Sarah Morgan is in the house. Sarah, where are you? Yeah. And Sarah is a true prophetess. She is a true daughter of Morris and Teresa Cerullo. She's the president of Prayer University, has an amazing ministry of imparting prayer. And then the bishop is in the house, Brian Bolt. We love you so much. God bless you. He is coming tomorrow afternoon. God has given him a great church, and a great teaching and preaching ministry, but he has a real gift of miracles and a real passion for the power and the miracle power of God. And, you know, one of the prayers that we need to learn how to pray is, Lord, how can you work miracles? How can you heal through my life? And so tomorrow afternoon, Brian is going to be releasing you into a ministry of praying for healing, for miracles. And then we're going to have a time of praying for miracles. And then tomorrow night will be the closing anointing and impartation service with Dr. Larry Lee. So I just want to tell you, plug yourself in and just give the Lord. There's no greater investment that you could make in your life than being here and asking the Lord to take your prayer life, because any other thing in your life that you're asking God to do, it's going to be a result. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom, and then all these things will be added to you. So I just want to encourage you, stay connected. Tomorrow morning, we have a special prayer breakfast with Dr. Lee. It is sold out. It's sold out in 72 hours. So that's at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. We had, so there's no more room in the breakfast. That's at 8 o'clock. But if you would like to meet us at the wall, because we're going to go right from that breakfast, we're going to have from 8 to 8:30, and then we're going to 8:30, we're going to go to the wall, and Larry Lee is going to do something I have seen him do many times. I was a student at Oral Roberts University when he was the dean, and he would call a prayer meeting for the whole campus at 6 a.m. Now look, college students getting up at 6 a.m. to pray, you know God is moving. And there would be sometimes 1,500 students that would come to that prayer meeting. I remember you used to bring your son. He was a little guy then. Yeah, he graduated from ORU. And I'll never forget, Larry would come and he'd be wearing like his Adidas or Nike kind of sweats. You know, it was very, you know, it was in the morning. He didn't come with suit and tie at 6 o'clock, but he came to pray and he would pray through the Lord's Prayer. And that's what we're going to do at the wall. So you're all invited to meet us at the wall if you would like to. Just spend the day at Legacy. 8:30, we'll meet at the wall. Then we'll go right into the service tomorrow with Bishop, with Al. We'll take a little break. And then we'll come back at 2 o'clock and just ask the Lord just to continue to infuse us. And Sarah and Pastor Brian will be ministering. And then at 4 o'clock, we're going to go into the Legacy Center. If you've never been in the Soaring Over Israel, the 4D Theater, we're going to open it up from 4 to 6 o'clock. And then we'll come back in here at 6:30 tomorrow night. And I tell you what, you are going to be praying. You're not even going to recognize your prayers when this thing is over. And I tell you what, Sunday morning is going to be like a brand new life. And so I just want to encourage you. Amen. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. God is not somebody that's trying to short-circuit your destiny. God is looking for ways to reward you. God is looking for ways to fulfill your destiny. And so God is a rewarder, but we have to do something. The Bible says it's called diligently seeking him. Yep, Saturday morning, just plan to be here all day and you watch the reward of God. Well, we want to take you into something now. Starting on Monday, we're going to continue this. We're starting the online Morris Cerullo Lord Teach Us to Pray School of Ministry. It's free. You have got to be a part. You don't have to join us live. We're live every day on Facebook at 9 o'clock presenting Dr. Cerullo's teachings. It is the most powerful. I wish we only have a time to hit the tip of the iceberg here, but this is 7 hours or so over about 7 or 8 days. It is powerful. We're going to show you about a 10-minute clip tonight from the Lord Teach Us to Pray School of Ministry. But I just want to encourage you to connect with the School of Ministry. Talking about QR codes, there's a QR code on the other side of the card where you can register for the School of Ministry. It'll take you about 30 seconds. And so I want to encourage you to do it. So here's what I want to do tonight. I want to show you a little testimony that we just received. It's only about a minute and a half. Al, you're going to love this. Brian, you're going to love this. This is incredible. This is a witch doctor from the nation of Uganda. I remember Larry's testimony of the witch that switched. I'll tell you what, this is a man. It was powerful. This was a man who, when he was born, was given from the womb to a witch, and he had all of these crazy powers and experiences. And then he had an experience that changed his life. You're going to just see a little 1 minute kind of testimony from this man who's now a pastor, who is now bringing deliverance to his nation. And it really is part of a little spot that we're putting out now on the School of Ministry, because this is what happens in the School of Ministry. What happened to this man? There's a power. There's an impartation. This is not a school of head knowledge. We're going to show you that, and then we're going to go straight into 10 minutes of Dr. Cerullo in the Lord Teach Us to Pray School of Ministry in Chicago, when he tells the story of the night that 300 witch doctors came to kill him in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, and how the Lord delivered him and what he did. It's one of the greatest stories you'll ever see. So Cynthia, if you are ready, we're going to go right to Uganda, then straight into Brother Cerullo's short message. Why don't we give the Lord a hand clap as we do, in Jesus' name.
Still in the occult, and I was in the city in Kampala, and I remember I got instruction from our leaders to vacate the city and stay away 70 miles away from the city and remove all our operations, because a man of God was coming in the city. And I remember we were told that if we stay in the city where that man is, his prayer would kill us all convert us. And I remember the instruction was stay out of the city 70 miles away.
Wow.
But also do not enter the city even 21 days
after
he has left. So I was still in the occult, and I was like, what kind of power is this? Because I knew the power, I knew Satan, I knew I had been all in these kind of powers. But then we were being warned not be around that man's, where he is in the city, 70. That man was Morris Cerullo. So he was coming in the city, and I remember we were told, stay out of the city 70 miles away and do not enter the city another 21
That's
days.
Incredible.
Because even after 21 days, his power, the effect of his power, remains in the atmosphere after 21 days. Wow. He has been in the city.
And the 10th verse, but before I read that, let me go to the 9th verse. I believe Jeremiah was one of God's real spiritual warfare specialists. Jeremiah 1:9. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. Now listen. There's an awful lot of incredible prayer that goes up just in the natural. Now, remember, I went to Haiti many years ago, early 1960s. I was just a young boy. When I arrived in that nation, one of the most demon-infested nations in the world, just a little short air flight from the United States of America. America needs to be ashamed of itself. You say, why, Morris? Because we claim to have so much Christianity and we allow just an hour away from our shores one of the most demon-infested nations in the world. And we can't take it. Come on, don't look at me with that look. As a little boy, God sent me over there. Crusade, big stadium, downtown. Before I got there, my posters and handbills were torn down by the priests. And they took them into their orgies. And they put them up in their little huts. And they stuck me full of pins. And they marched around me, trying to put curses on me. When I landed, it was quite an experience. We were there as the guest of the president, Duvalar, the dictator. Now his dead son's been thrown out of the country. You all know what's happened in Haiti. When I landed there, and a large group of business people were there with Brother Cerullo, 20 or 30, the senators came out to meet us. Senator Arthur Bonhomme, who is a wonderful Christian, spirit-filled. They had a long motor arcade ready to go by the palace. I got off of the plane, was escorted into the leading car, long, sleek, black car. And all of a sudden, I got sick in the pit of my stomach. I said to my song leader, who was alongside of me, that time it was a Swedish man. I said to him, tell that driver to get out of this motor arcade. He said, you can't do that. We're going by the palace. I said, I can't help it. Palace, no palace. Get me out. He said, what's the matter? I said, don't ask any questions. He said to Arthur, sitting in the front seat, he said, Brother Cerullo wants out. He wants to go to his hotel room. And he turned around and he looked at me. I said, I'm awful sorry. I don't mean to be disruptive. I said, but I have got to get to my hotel room. So they broke out of the motor arcade, took me to my hotel room. I fell on the floor in a pool of sweat. I said, God, what is going on? 1961. I said, what is going on? I said, I feel like I'm dying. My stomach is in terrible pain. God said, son, I allowed this to happen to you for a reason. I wanted you out of that motor arcade. I wanted to talk to you. All of a sudden, my pain left. I'm lying on the floor in this hotel room. I said, what is it, God? God said, I wanted to tell you that tonight there's 300 witch doctors coming to kill you. I said, that's fine. I'm not consecrated unto life, I'm consecrated unto death. I said, now what? What am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to die as a martyr? God said, no. He said, I'm going to tell you how to identify him. And he showed me how to identify him. Showed me the color of the clothes that they were going to be wearing. And he showed me how to pick them out of the crowd. Then he said to me the most startling thing. He said to me, son, and I never even thought about this scripture way back in 1961 about Jeremiah. He said to me, son, he said, tonight, the word that you speak will be exactly as if I have spoken it. And whatever you speak, I'll bring to pass. I get out there to the meeting. There was 30,000 people. It was a riot. It was a mess. Demas Shakarian, at that time, was president of the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship, now gone on to be with Jesus. He was trying to lead the service, trying to get order. I mean, it was havoc. When I walked into the stadium, there was no place for me to get through. I had to walk through the crowd. Got up on the stage. As soon as I got up there, no introduction, he turned around, walked off, and gave me the microphone. The place was a mess. I stood up, greeted the people, started to talk, and God showed me what they were going to do. Little chance. They started here and they went here and they went there and they went the other place. And I called for order. Oh, that chanting on that organ. Sing Amazing Grace or something. I called for order. They stopped. I went on and talked for 2 or 3 more minutes, and they started again. God showed me they're going to rush the platform. They're going to kill me. I called for order. They stopped. They started again. I'll never forget my little interpreter. He was a Bible school student. I won't tell you what was already happening to him. He was wet. They speak a Creole French language. I turn around, I put my finger in his face, and I said to him, son, I said, I know how you feel. I said, but don't you dare say one word but exactly what I say. Then I told the people, I said, people of Haiti, there are hundreds of witch doctors here tonight. And I said, you've come to kill me. You say, how do I know this? I said, because the living God told me. Now, this is no fooling. That platform was filled with dignitaries because when you're invited by the dictator, they're all there. Place was filled with senators. Full Gospel Businessmen, Demas Shakarian, were all on the platform. And I said, God, the living God, has told me that you've come here tonight to kill me. I said, now I know exactly where you are and who you are. And I started to point them out. And I said, tonight, we're going to find out whether the devil that you serve or the God that I serve has more power. And I turned around to the senators and the wives sitting there with their little white babushkas on their head, trying to act like they were Catholic. And I turned around and I said to them, I said, before all of these dignitaries, I said, I will not be responsible. I said, open your mouth one more time. And I said, I will not be responsible when they carry you out of this meeting dead. You could hear a pin drop. Not a soul moved. Not one person spoke. And I preached for 20 minutes, and all of a sudden, in the back of the stadium, somebody let out a scream. And they took a little baby, a little child, looked like 4 or 5 years of age, and they started to push it over the heads of the people until they got it down to the front of the platform. And I looked at my interpreter, and I said, what's happening? And he said to me, Brother Cerullo, somebody shouted way in the back there that this little child, this little baby, while you were preaching, who was born totally blind, all of a sudden began to reach around in the arms of the person that was holding them, the mother and the father, and began to see. And the blindness is gone. The little child is perfectly healed. And he said that they just threw the baby up here because they didn't know what else to do with it. Now, I got the mother and the father through the crowd. And when we got them through the crowd, and they stood there with their blind baby, perfectly healed, perfectly healed, perfectly healed. The general behind me stood up. And I can see him to this day with all of his uniform of war. And he put his hands on his head like this and he said, scream. He said, my God. He said, that's my neighbor. Weeks, night and day, morning service, afternoon service, evening service. It took only 2 weeks and we shut the Mardi Gras down. They had to stop because there was nobody in the streets. They were all in the crusade getting saved. Somebody say authority. This new level of strategic prayer that will penetrate the darkness has to be anointed with divine spiritual authority that gives power to our words that we speak.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Let's stand together.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generation. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock, oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. Oh, on your faithfulness. I'm calling on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the Lord. All things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh
you are.
welcomed in my heart. Come and have your way. God, need us face to face. All consuming, move without restraint. Your kingdom move, all our faith and hope in our great God. Let the heavens open, that your kingdom move, all our faith and hope in our great God. Your heart's desire.
Tonight, I want you just to take about 30 seconds. If you have the prayer language of the Holy Spirit, I want you just to go ahead. The Bible says, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue, he doesn't speak to man, but he speaks to God. I want you to go ahead and just talk to him. And if you do not have the prayer language of the Holy Spirit, if you'll just go ahead and lift your hands and just begin to open your mouth, and you just begin to let the words come out of your mouth, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit gave them utterance. Oh, bless your name, bless your name, bless your name. Go ahead and give the Lord Jesus, come on, give Jesus a mighty hand clap of praise. While you're at it, give our Father who art in heaven, give him a mighty hand clap of praise. Come on, let somebody welcome the Holy Spirit. You are welcome in this place. The Bible says that God gave gifts to the church. He gave the gift of the prophet. Tomorrow morning, the prophet, the gift of the prophet will be in this room. You do not want to miss Bishop Clarence McClendon. But there is a gift of God, a man that Morris and Teresa love so very much. Larry, it's just like a dream. I mean, I feel like I'm just dreaming. To see you standing right where you are standing. If you don't know who this man is, if you don't know what this man carries, you know, you say the name Morris Cerullo, you're going to say power. You might say prophet. You might say apostle. Or you say Billy Graham, you're going to say souls. You say John Avanzini, you're going to say financial breakthrough. You say Benny Hinn, you're going to say miracles. But when you say Larry Lee, you're going to say prayer. This man has been raised up by God with one of the most unique ministries to mobilize prayer. His book, Could You Not Tarry With Me 1 Hour, has literally covered the globe so many times. I've been in services, conferences of yours, Dr. Lee, where there would be 10, 15,000 people that would come just for a day just to hear what you're going to share with us tonight and again tomorrow night. Many of the times when Dr. Cerullo would go into some of the big cities in America and around the world, Larry would come and he would go ahead and he would have these incredible times of prayer and then teach in our conferences. This was a man that Oral Roberts, Dr. Morris Cerullo called an apostle of prayer. If we were ever going to have a conference on Lord Teach Us to Pray, there would not be anybody, I mean, that I would rather, and I tell you, the Lord said, and I said, I don't even know, it's been 20 or so years, and you know, I've been following you from a distance. God is using him in a great way. I said, Lord, help me to get reconnected, and we did, and we began to talk, and Larry said, I just feel like God is doing something here in San Diego in legacy. I want to honor Morris, Teresa. I want you to give a great San Diego Morris Cerullo World Evangelism welcome to God's servant, Dr. Larry Lee. The general is in the house.
This is amazing. Amen. I'm standing before you and I'm literally trembling at the presence of God. How many of you sense that incredible, unmistakable, immutable power? And it's a power that the Holy Spirit has released in this house tonight so that you can have an experience. Everybody say the word experience. The word experience is so important. I spent 4 years in Baptist University. Then I spent 6 years in Baptist Seminary, and I never heard one teaching in 10 years of higher education. Not one lecture, not one teaching on prayer, Clarence. Bishop McClendon, I love you so much tonight. First Lady, I love you, and the pastors, Sarah Morgan. There's enough prayer power on the front row to shake the world three times over. The anointing is in this place, and I love you from my heart. Before you take your seat, I want you to lift a hand and say, Lord, let me have a revelation that causes me to have an experience that will ground me in my prayer life, where I will be praying, if the Lord tarries, and until the Lord comes again. Father, let it be in this house tonight a revelation that will ground us, yes, Lord, that will ground us and settle us and establish us and cause us from this place forward, Father, to be men and women that are set, and we are running a good race, fighting a good fight. And we find in our own lives that there is a manifestation that only God could be glorified in, because we didn't do it. The Lord himself did it. And we give him all the glory and all the praise. And somebody turn to your neighbor on the left and the right and say, it shall be done. Amen. If you would, take your seat. I honestly am standing before you on holy ground, because I know that where I stand is a place where Dr. Cerullo, his precious wife Teresa, now they're glorifying God in heaven, but yet I learned today he's winning more souls today than he was when he was on the earth. Now, that may seem strange to you, but through the miracles of technology, God is using the message and the ministry of Dr. Cerullo in a way that only God could be glorified in it. And this great 18 acres of ground that belongs to the kingdom of God, amen, is a testament to what only the Lord can do, and he is going to do greater things than these in the years to come. Take that for what it's worth, because that is prophetic. As I was standing over here just a moment ago, the Lord began to speak to me. Pray they have an experience where they experience the force and the power of the blood of Jesus. Now, we know the blood will never lose its power. How many believe the blood has redeemed you forever? Amen. It's bought you out of the slave market of sin and set you into the family of God. That's why the title of this great conference is Lord, Teach Us to Pray. The very first part of the prayer that teaches us how to pray is Our Father, which art in heaven. How many of you know God is not having a nervous breakdown tonight? How many of you know God is not nervous tonight? And God in heaven is settled and set on what He's doing, but He's waiting for voices to agree with Him on earth. For you see, the blood is speaking tonight. The blood is speaking better things. Amen. And every part of that prayer that Jesus gave, piece by piece, I didn't understand it when the Lord gave it to me. I said, Lord, that's the Catholic's prayer. That's the prayer we as Protestants and Evangelicals and Pentecostals, we sing at or we speak at weddings and funerals. What is that that you're telling me to read? For I said, Lord, where is it? Because I had been pastoring a church with 14 people that grew to a church of well over 10,000 on 50 acres of ground on the freeway in Texas. Somebody give God praise. There were 5,000 people in Rockwall, Texas when I moved there, and there were well over 11,000 members in the church when the Lord spoke to my heart and said, now, if you give me this one church, I'll give you the nations of the world. And I'm going to go ahead and tell you the rest of what he said. He said, and you will see great and mighty things which you knew not, and you'll also experience great suffering. We don't like that very much, do we? I didn't get any amens on that. But the Bible says that Paul's self-revelation, his self-opening to the world, was that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. When he heard, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness, he said something that sounded so crazy to me when I first read it, I had to read it again. He said, therefore, I will rather glory in my infirmities. For when I am weak, then am I strong. And now I have been preaching this revelation that I'm bringing to you tonight. I've been preaching it for a little over 30 years, but I've been preaching the gospel for 51 years this year. Wow, how about that? And the Lord, by His grace and mercy, continues to strengthen and to settle and to build me. And the work continues, amen. Let me tell you, we're all growing, amen. I have to tell a story about our friend Morris Cerullo. I remember one night we were coming out at Earl's Court. I did the mission to London, I think, 4 or 5 times where I would preach and minister. And one night, Dr. Cerullo came out and just started calling out miracles, started calling out people infirmities. And there they came running, getting healed from everywhere. Well, when it was all over with, we went to our favorite restaurant. And Greg Morrow knows exactly where that was in London, Ilepi's, where they had garlic gravy that stayed with you for a week. That's true. And Dr. Cerullo, I finally got a moment, just he and I said, Dr. Cerullo, how did you do those miracles? Where did they come from? And he said back to me, he said, I brought the miracles into the meeting with me. In other words, while he was praying, he was listening. He was hearing, not some impression or some emotional feeling. No, he was hearing a distinct, clear word in his spirit when Jesus was on the earth. And by the way, How many believe Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever? And he said, as the Father sent me, even so send I you. And so how did Jesus go about? He went from one place of prayer to the next place of prayer, and in between he worked his supernatural ministry. That was his whole life. To the Garden of Gethsemane, he prayed through three times. I saw Bishop McClendon's phrase that he's going to be preaching on tomorrow. I don't know if you will or not, but coming to the place of grace. You see, he prayed through to the place he had prayed through, to a place called grace, where the angels came and strengthened him for the suffering that he will endure, so that in that place of grace, even though he suffered greatly, hallelujah, death could not hold him. And he's living today, but he didn't stop his earthly ministry. I wrote a book one time called The Highest Call of All, and someone challenged me. They said, why, Dr. Lee, do you think this is the highest call of all? I said, it's because what Jesus did while he was on the earth, and after he had risen from the dead, he ascended to the right hand of the Father. He put his blood on the altar of God. And that's where we're headed tonight. That blood that was on that altar began to speak from that altar. And I'm going to tell you what it was saying, and then I hope I can share with you a little bit of what Jesus is praying over you. But Jesus right now is doing the same thing tonight that he was doing when he was on the earth. He promised me years ago that when I stood and began to preach on prayer, he would start praying for every person in the room. So I don't know how long it's going to take me to get through this tonight, but I think it'll take about as long as it will take for him to pray over every one of you here tonight. Somebody lift a hand and say, pray for me, Jesus. Amen. And we're getting in agreement with that same Jesus tonight, because that same Jesus that's praying over you is waiting to hear your voice. And what did I hear in my experience? Now, I'm sharing with you something that I did not learn in years of seminary training, earned doctor's degrees. I did not learn this from theology school. I learned this as I was willing to let the big church go, going back and beginning to pray at 5 a.m. for 18 months in a row with a man of God that Bishop McClendon knew that's now in heaven. But I tell you, I got up and I prayed. We were going to have a three-week-long revival. The three-week-long revival lasted 7 weeks. But it got Brother Wilhite and I, my pastor that I was praying, it got us both fired. Because half of the people getting saved, and we're talking about, we walked onto the campus at Tatum High School down in East Texas, and the children began to just break loose with weeping and crying. When our feet hit the ground, they began to repent. Nobody said a word. They didn't have school that day because the children, yeah, they felt the power of God. And it ripped that place apart. Whole football teams were getting saved. Did you hear what I said? And it wasn't the cheerleaders that got saved first. It was a linebacker that was on a high school All-American got saved. Then his whole team got saved. Then his coaches got saved. Then the cheerleaders got saved. Somebody give God glory. And it was a revival that lasted 7 weeks. But we got fired because of it, because half of the children that got saved were black. And our lily white church and East Texas back in those days would not let us baptize the black children in their white church. So they came to my pastor and said, you can leave and take your boy, that was me, take your boy with you. And when I was up in British Columbia teaching the message you're about to hear, the Holy Spirit said, go to Rockwall, Texas, a town with one blinking light, one Dairy Queen, and one high school. and establish my people there, and I had no idea what God was going to do. I thought the revelation that God had given me in those 18 months after I had my experience, and I'm coming back and saying that word on purpose, repeating that word again and again, because one morning while I was there at that 5 a.m. prayer meeting that lasted for 18 months with my dear pastor that's in heaven now, I literally had an open vision. How many believe it? Young men will see visions. And I saw in my vision Jesus emptying a basin, beautiful platinum-looking large basin, walking up to an altar area, and immutable light was behind the altar, and I perceived that to be God, who is a spirit, our Father. And he emptied the contents of the basin, and when the blood that was in the basin hit the altar of God, it began to speak. And you know what it was speaking? In Hebrew. I heard it. I think if I had not studied Hebrew, he would have said it in English. But he was getting the message through to me. The compound names of God, one after the other, I was hearing him say, Jehovah Tsidkenu, Jehovah Shammah, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Jireh. I was hearing it, and I was experiencing it, and I'd been saying to the Lord, these words that are the words that brought us here tonight, Lord, teach us to pray. Hebrews 10:19 is a proof text that I'll not lift out of a context tonight, but it is a certain proof text that this revelation is true. For I quoted from Hebrews 12:24, the blood speaks. Say it out loud. The blood speaks. Tell your neighbor the blood speaks. I can tell you what the blood is saying. It is speaking the compound names of God from the Old Testament, and all those names are comprehended in one name that is above every name. Come on, help me now. What's his name? Jesus. And Jesus, our Lord, is there at the right hand of the Father doing his eternal high priestly ministry. And so as I stand before you tonight, I was having an experience. How many of you believe that if you were caught up in a vision and you saw the blood hit the altar and it began to declare, Jehovah Yireh means Jehovah Jireh. In Hebrew, it's Yireh. It means the Lord who sees what you need before you ever ask him. And he's in the process of meeting all your needs, not according to your needs, but according to his riches and glory. Do you feel his presence here right now? Remember that, because he's about to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think, according to the riches that's working in us, the power of his spirit giving revelation and experience. And even so, there I was. What would you have been doing if you'd seen an open vision like that and you heard the Lord say, it's here in the Word. It's in the Word. I said, where, Lord? In the Word. And he said, read the rest of it. Lord, teach us to pray. And he said, after this manner, when you pray, say. And I honestly argued with the Lord, as I said a moment ago, that's not much of a little prayer. That's a nice prayer. Thank God he gave it. But he said to me, say it slowly. And when I said it slowly, it literally outlined itself before me that the blood paid for every part of that outline. And the Holy Spirit came back and filled in the blanks. Hear me now. When Jesus gave the outline, he was like our professors in seminary. They'd put an outline up on a board, and they would come back and fill in the blanks to their outline. Do you understand? They'd come back and say, point one, point two, point three. Well, there's 7 points to this outline. And Jesus did not fill in the blanks. He had said in John 16 and verse 13, and I'm quoting now, Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak of himself, but whatever he hears, that shall he also speak, and he will show you things to come. Are you receiving that? And so I saw that the blood was declaring God was my Father. What would you have been doing? Well, I can tell you what I was doing. I was about to have a Pentecostal runaway, but I couldn't run away because I'd fallen on the ground and couldn't get up. I was having such an experience with God. I felt such an incredible lifting of my inner man, and I was seeing something I had never seen in all those years of study and all those years of what I call holy misery, because I'd seen the Lord build a great church under my hand. As a matter of fact, years before, 1971, I'll go back even as Dr. Cerullo did in the video we just watched. In 71, I was a student at Dallas Baptist University about to graduate. And I'd fallen so in love with Jesus because he saved me out of a horrible pit. He lifted me up from a place where doctors thought there was no hope for me. How many believe that when there's no hope, there's still God? And he called me to the ministry, and I did not know what he meant other than I knew it was real, and I knew I was healed. And 3 years later, I was living in the ministry he called me to on the floor of that hospital. As I laid on the floor and did nothing but cry out, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And he took me in 1971 to the mountain that looks out over a beautiful lake there at Dallas Baptist University. And I had never been around Pentecostal people. I was a fourth generation Southern Baptist. Are you hearing this? And all I ever heard about the Holy Spirit was, now I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and the baptism for me. And the other thing I heard, stay away from those Pentecostal people that speak in tongues. I said, Lord, I don't have the words to tell you how much I love you. And I didn't. I said, Lord, I just don't know how to tell you. And all of a sudden, I heard this. And I said, Lord, that's going to ruin my ministry. And the Holy Spirit spoke, and I heard it as clearly as you're hearing me right now. He said, yes, that's going to ruin your ministry, but this is where my ministry begins in your life. Somebody help me shout. Somebody shout with me. Hallelujah. And that's where it all began. And then I went on a trek for the next 20 years almost, from 71 to 91. In what I call a time of holy misery, because we would pray. I mean, we prayed hard. Do y'all understand pray hard? We prayed till we spit blood. Y'all understand what I'm saying? We prayed our hearts out, and we were sincere in our prayers. But there was something missing, Prophetess Sarah Morgan. There was something missing. And I kept saying, Lord, what is it? And he kept saying to me, it's in the Word. Lord, teach us to pray. Can you imagine being one of those disciples that said when he finished his prayer, they were listening to him pray? How would you like to have been one of them right there? Whoa. What was that like? He said, when you pray, say, speak. Here's what you say. And I saw in my vision the blood speaking the names of God. And I began to say, Father, in heaven. And I would just go in English as much as I could. And then I would break out into tongues. How many understand what I'm saying? Now I'm going to give you something that Dr. Cho gave me years ago. I asked him when I first met him, I said, how did you get such a great church? How did you build such a great church? He said, I pray and I obey. He laughed because he made a rhyme. He just learned to speak a little bit of English at that time. Later, he said, I pray and I listen and I obey. Are y'all listening to this? How many believe that Jesus meant what he said? When he said, the Spirit will come and he will show you things to come. The Spirit will come, even as Dr. Cerullo said, I take the miracles into the meeting with me. And so I'm going to lead you for a moment in prayer, but I'm going to ask you to go along with me and not just listen, but be a participant, all right? Can you lift one hand and say, I'm glad God is my Father? Come on, can you just go ahead and thank him that you're bought out of the slave market of sin, out of the family of Satan, into the family of God, that he's a merciful, this is me, he's a kind, he's a gracious, he's a securing force. When the world's going crazy on every side, he's settled. And now would you, with that same hand lifted, just begin to pray with your spirit for a few moments. Karimakasitai. Go ahead. Focus on the fact that the blood is declaring that God is your heavenly Father. It said you were purchased not with silver and gold, but with the precious blood of the Lamb. Are you hearing this? And so that's the paternal part of the prayer. The paternal part of the prayer. Oh, the Spirit of God is in this place right now. I'm going to go through this quickly, but I'm not going to rush. I'm just going to give it to you step by step. Hallowed be your name, O Lord. How many believe that name, Jesus, is above every name? And can I just encourage you to praise him for a few moments, that he is your righteousness. He is your sanctification. He is your peace. He is your provider. He is your protector. He is your shepherd. All of those names. And I begin to thank him. That's who he is. And I do it in English until I can't say any more in English. And it's the same thing. I pray then with the Holy Spirit. And I pray until I'm done. Sometimes I've come to my little prayer place where I pray. And I'll be praying along. And I'm going, God, I'm so today. And in that moment, I'll shift gears. How many of you understand shift gears? I'll go from that prayer language into intercessory prayer, and then I go into warfare prayer. There's levels of prayer. And I can just say that I know when it's time to shift gears, because the Spirit within me will quicken me, and I'll find myself going from into. You understand what I'm saying to you? And then I take a moment, now watch this, right then, to listen. Listen to Jesus. My precious wife and I have a son named Noah. He grew up in my house praying with me from the time he was a little guy. He's 24 years old now. Noah used to dress up when we would attend Bishop McClendon's church, and I had the honor and the privilege of serving in this man's house. And what an awesome time. And I looked up and I saw Noah in his little suit and tie. He couldn't have been more than 3 or 4 or 5 years old. Is that about right, Leah? And I said, where are you going, Noah, today? He said, I'm going to see the bishop. That's what he said. I'm going to go see the bishop. And it was a beautiful thing. But we've learned to listen to Jesus, because the blood is speaking in your behalf. And Jesus is interceding for you according to the speaking of the blood. That's a powerful word. I pray you can lock it into your psyche spiritually in such a way that you'll never forget it, because this is the secret to continuing in prayer. As long as you think prayer is how much carpet you eat when you're down on your face praying, or how long you pray. No. I wrote a book called Could You Not Tarry 1 Hour? Dr. Cho looked at me when the first time I went to Korea, and he said, you know, you wrote a very good book. Something really does happen when you pray 1 hour. He said, you're going to preach for me next Sunday morning. I said, wonderful. What time? He said, 6 a.m. I said, good. That's a good time to preach. That's when we pray every day at our church. He said, I heard about that. He said, well, you're going to preach for our deacons. I said, oh, that'll be great. Probably 200 or 300 people were there. There were 40,000 people there that morning. Yeah, I'm telling you. It was an amazing experience. But in growing up, finding our way, we saw the Lord do so many things. About that same time, our son Noah, he had a little trouble with his saying his L's. His L's were W's. You know how little children have trouble sometimes with their letters? And he met a lady on the street as we were walking down the street, and he said to her, he said, this is my dad, wowee wee. This is my mama, wee a wee. And every time when we get through walking through the prayer, day after day after day, he said, let's stop and listen to Jesus. You won't forget that. It's time to begin to listen to Jesus. We are living, I don't have to tell you, in perilous times. And those who are not just survivors, but more than conquerors, will be people who have listened while they were praying. And they obeyed at any cost. And it did not matter what it cost them. They prayed, they listened, and they obeyed. And so when you come to that part of worshiping Him, the first part of the prayer, everybody say paternal. That's the fatherly part. Then there's the presence part, worshiping Him for His great name. Comprehended in all the names of the old covenant into the new covenant, we have that name that's above every name. And as we praise Him for what His blood has done, we enter His gates with thanksgiving in our heart. And you'll find yourself, if you'll focus on the blood and praise His name, you'll go into the presence of God every time. Turn and tell somebody every time. I'm still at this now. I'm still at this now all these years later, because I've still been able to come in through many dangers, toils, and snares. I still come in the same way. There's only one way to get in, and that's through the speaking of the blood. Having therefore, brethren, boldness, we enter the Holy of Holies by the blood of Jesus. Come, kingdom of God. Be done, will of God. The verbs come first. You see, we don't get into His presence just to enjoy His presence. The first part is the paternal part. The second part is the presence part, worshiping. If it was just worship and it was just enjoying His presence, that would be enough. Would it not be? Just to have His presence would be enough. But He led us on into the prayer to the what I call the priority part. Doesn't it say, seek ye first the kingdom of God? Matthew 6, He gave the disciples the same prayer that He gave in Luke 11 when they said, Lord, teach us to pray. How many of Jesus woke up, or you woke up in the middle of the night and Jesus was standing at the foot of your bed and say, when you wake up in the morning, pray my way, pray the Jesus way. How many would at least try it His way? How many? Oh, we have some very intelligent people here tonight. God bless you. It was Jesus who didn't say it once. He said it twice. In the beginning of His ministry, Matthew 6, 9 through 11. Then in Luke 11, verses 1 through 4, it's the same topical outline. And that priority part of the prayer, the verbs come first. And the idea is someone making a declaration. This is not an invocation. This is not asking God to do something He doesn't want to do. Your eye has not seen, your ear has not heard. It has not entered your heart yet the things that God has pre-prepared for those who love Him. He has already prepared your steps before you, but guess what? He's waiting to hear your voice so He can, listen now, so He can activate your angels to fight for you. And when He sees you spiritually, put your foot down and say, come, kingdom of God, in righteousness, peace, and joy. and power in me. Glory to God. For the kingdom does not come with fancy words or fancy sermons, but it comes in power. Power. I know I'm right. And so I'm standing before you tonight declaring it's as a man putting his foot down. And I do it not only over my life, but over my family. Then I do it over our church. Then I do it over the harvest. And I say, give up north, south, east, west. Give up the harvest that belongs to the kingdom of God. Can you imagine for 4 years adding 100 new members to your church every week? I couldn't imagine it, but I was watching the angels like lightning shot out into the darkness, and I kept seeing it. I said, Lord, what is that? He said, those are the ministering spirits ministering to the heirs of salvation, and they were coming, being drawn irrevocably by the Holy Spirit into the house of God, and they could not say no, Bishop. They could not say no, Pastor, they had to come. Why? Because the Lord had put the holy drawing force of that same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, and they were coming in. So it's come, kingdom of God. Be done, will of God. And usually there's some warfare that goes on right there. Usually we go from into, and we know, now I pray I'm not offending you. I pray I'm not hurting your little heart. But the apostle said, what is it then? I will. Everybody say, I will. I will pray with the understanding, and I will pray also with the Spirit. And so I start out praying with the understanding as Jesus taught us, the priority part, and then I move into the realm of the Spirit. And then I move into the place where I listen to Jesus. And so I stand before you and I talk to you tonight about the priority part of the prayer, where we seek first his kingdom in us, be done will of God through us. And there's a whole multitude of people that are out there ready right now to come into the house of God, to come into the kingdom of God. And they're crying out for somebody that will speak the word, not in the church, but outside these walls. We tell somebody, Jesus is alive. He's living, and he's worthy of our praise. Be done, will of God, through my life. And then there's the part where I will not skip over. I pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And I unashamedly pray for Jews throughout the world. The Bible teaches us to do that. Isn't it interesting that he said they will prosper who love her? And the very next part of the prayer is the prosperity part of the prayer. Give us this day our daily bread. How many of you would wave at me and say, I believe Jesus is still an excellent bread maker? 5 loaves and 2 fishes a little boy brought. The prosperity part of the prayer. And you say, well, what did the blood do about that? He redeemed us, amen, and gave to us a covenant called the Abrahamic covenant, amen. And the curse of the law was broken through the blood of Jesus. I trace every bit of this prayer back to the blood of Jesus. The blood bought our redemption from the curse. Amen. So when I say, give us this day our daily bread, I am declaring in faith that he is a great provider. And I can say with the Apostle Paul, I know how to abase and I know how to abound, but I like abounding better than abasing. Amen. But the times I've had to abase, I have found out that Jesus was the same. Amen. And I found out he was able to do things that I couldn't do, even right up to tonight. Amen. Jesus is up to something tonight because he's giving us our daily bread. How many are thankful that after Jesus received the offering. He not only received it, he blessed it, put his hands on it. He broke it, and then he distributed it. Can I not submit to you that that's what he does with your life? When you give your life to him, he receives you. He will in no wise cast you out. He blesses you, and you say, look at me now, and then he will break you. And then the oil starts coming out. The good stuff starts coming out then. The real Holy Spirit business starts being accomplished through your life. Be done, will of God. The priority part. And then the provision part. Give us this day our daily bread. And then I love this, the pardon part of the prayer. I want us to take a few moments just to worship the Lord right now, that he has pardoned us once for all. One time when Jesus shed his blood and that blood was put on that altar, he declared that you were pardoned in Jesus' name. Now you have to receive it, but I want everybody that will receive it to lift your hands right now. And I want you to begin to thank him in your native tongue. Lord, I want to thank you that that blood is there. You're able to forgive, and you also forget. Lord, thank you that you have let us amputate the past and cut it off in the name of Jesus so that we can live in this world full of your presence. Lord, we thank you that the blood, hallelujah, watch this. It says if we confess our sins, the lust of our flesh, the lust of our eyes, the pride of our life, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. But listen, and then he cleanses us from all unrighteousness, stuff you don't even know you did wrong. Stuff you didn't even know that was off on the inside. How many of you know we're all still growing? Amen. And everybody here is being healed of something all the time. And so we praise you for the pardon part of the prayer. We thank you, oh Lord Jesus, just for a few moments. Pray with your spirit. Pray with your spirit because the blood right now is being applied. The blood right now is washing and cleansing, healing and delivering right now. Go ahead. Listen to the Lord, for he'll speak to you right there. The pardon part of the prayer leads us into the power part, for we overcome the accuser of the brethren. There are two voices in heaven. One is an accuser of the brethren, and the other is the intercessor for the brethren. And you have to choose which one you're going to follow. Are you going to be an accuser of the brethren? Or are you going to be an intercessor for the brethren? Because there's not any of us here that at one time or another in our life, we did not need somebody to be shaming us because of our past. No. Everybody here has gone through something in their life. But aren't you glad that there was somebody in heaven interceding for you and somebody on earth interceding for you? You remember the accuser said to the Father, look at your righteous servant Job. Would he serve you if he lost everything? And so the Lord allowed that to happen, but there was an intercessor there. And he was praying for Job. What happened to Job? He got twice as much in the end. Anybody up for twice as much? Come on now, talk to me. And so that's the pardon part of the prayer that leads us into the power part of the prayer. And I quickly bring this message, which I pray will go into you, because this is the prayer that teaches us how to pray. I didn't make it up. I got on an elevator one night, and a very famous preacher got on there with me. He's a big guy, bigger than me, and he started saying, I don't need your prayer teaching. I said, well, brother, I'm a peacemaker. I don't want to argue theology with you. I've been arguing with my brethren for 10 years. I'm through with all the, I don't do that anymore. He said, no, and he started thumping me on the shoulder like that. And then I knew I had an attitude problem on my hand. And I said to him, I said, well, first of all, this is not my prayer outline. This is not what I taught the church. This was the outline Jesus gave, and he didn't come back and fill in the blanks. He said, you go wait till the Holy Spirit comes, and he will guide you into all truth. Are you following? And so the Holy Spirit, when you say, the Bible says we overcome the accuser of the brethren, how? Come on. By what? The blood of the Lamb. There it is again. The word of our testimony. Why? Because we've laid down our lives even to death. We want to give him glory in this place tonight. Why? Because we are more than conquerors through him that loved us and gave himself for us. The anointing of the Holy Spirit is in this place right now to set the captive free. It can happen right where you're seated. Doesn't have to be me laying my hands on you to get it. I can speak in Jesus' name that there's a breaking of all kinds of disobedience, all kinds of doubt. There it goes. Doubt, go out. All kinds of diseases, all kinds of arthritis and stomach disorders. They're leaving right now. Why? Because I'm speaking what I heard. Jesus right now. Somebody say hallelujah. I will stand in the power of the name of Jesus. I'm standing before you right now saying at that point, I've learned well to put on my armor. How many know that we don't need a bunch of spiritual streakers running through the world? Amen. We need to put our armor on. What does that mean? That means you're putting on the Lord Jesus Christ so that when you walk out of your prayer time, the devil may see you coming, but it doesn't know if it's you or Jesus. Help me now. My loins are girt about with truth. Who is the way, the truth, and the life? Say his name. Put the breastplate of righteousness. Who is your righteousness? My feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Who is your readiness? He's the ever ready one. He's always ready. Who is our faith? Our faith is in him, but our faith is also by him. For by grace are we saved through faith, and that not of ourselves. It was given. Faith cometh. Therefore, it's something that the Lord imputed into you and prepared you to hear the word of faith. And in that, you can stand with your shield of faith and quench all the fiery darts of the devil. Reach up and pull that helmet down over your head and say, my mind is the mind of Christ. I will think his thoughts. And when I think his thoughts, I'll speak the sixth part of the armor. I will speak the word of God, which is a living word. Amen. You see, the apostle said, take unto you the whole armor of God. He said, you put on the whole armor of God. A lot of us think it just automatically happens. John Wesley said it best. He said, when Jesus gave this outline in prayer, it was the everyday prayer because it says, give us this day our daily bread. And so I don't need to do this every other day. I got to do it every day. Amen. Somebody say every day. I said to Oral Roberts, I was there for 5 years on campus and commuted back and forth from my church there in Rockwall, Texas, which was just outside of Dallas, about 30 miles. The first couple years I drove it. Can you believe that? Back and forth from Texas to Tulsa. It's about a 4 or 5 hour drive. Until I told Dr. Cho, I said, Dr. Cho, he told me, he said, you know, Dr. Lee, I sure would like to meet Oral Roberts. He's my spiritual father. And I remember I said to Dr. Cho, oh, I can introduce you to him. I'm the dean of the seminary there. He said, you don't know Oral Roberts. I said, oh, yeah, I know him. I play golf with him. Amen. He's a funny guy to play golf with. One day he hit a ball in the water, and I said, Brother Roberts, you lost that ball. He said, no, I didn't. I sowed it to the golf course as a seed. I mean, he's a funny guy. He's in that great cloud of witnesses, and I believe they're praying too. I mean, I don't know that, but I believe it. Amen. Because they're following Jesus, and what's Jesus doing? There it is. And I said to Brother Roberts, I said, that's just six pieces, and that's the number of man or the number of incompletion. I said, what's the seventh piece of the armor? He said, keep reading. Watch this now. Truth, righteousness, readiness, faith, helmet of salvation, sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The next verse says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. And then he said, and pray for me too. And so we're going to do a little exercise right now. Reach your hand out toward me right now and pray your best prayer for me. Come on, I need it. I need it. If the Apostle Paul said, pray for me, I promise you he needed it. And I'm receiving your prayer right now. And I thank you for the seven pieces of the armor. For it's through your intercessions we keep going and we keep ministering and we stay in the Holy Spirit. Even so, right now, put your hand on your heart and I'm going to intercede over you right now. Fill them right now, O Lord, with this revelation. Let this be an experience that they will never forget tonight. Let this anointing that is now filling this room, the anointing of the Holy Spirit is a prayer anointing. Oh, let the prayer anointing, oh God, encompass all their lives tonight. And let them be baptized in it so greatly they wake up in the middle of the night and hear themselves praying in the Spirit. Cause this anointing to break every yoke in their life. And cause this anointing to do what you do, O Lord. You lead them in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. Even so, O Lord, tonight we declare that there's a last part of this teaching. And it's the word amen. Isn't it amazing that the last part after the right before the amen is thine is the kingdom. Come on, say it with me. Thine is the power. Say it with me. Thine is the glory. Say it with me. Lift your hands with me and let's give him the glory that's due his name. For the prayer starts with hallowed be thy name, worship. It ends with thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. And then we say the amen. The amen doesn't mean it's over. The amen means it shall be done. It means everything. Go ahead and praise the Lord. It means everything you prayed about will continue as long as you continue to praise God for it during the day. And that's why the Bible says rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. I started to tell you my favorite Morris Cerullo story because I had the privilege of going with Dr. Cerullo and his precious wife, Teresa, all over America and really all over the world. And we traveled to many nations. I remember the great meeting in Jerusalem, downtown Jerusalem. I remember when we traveled to island nations and preached to multitudes of people, and it was amazing when we finally made a decision to go to India. Dr. Cerullo was a giver. How many believe to reap like he reaped, he had to sow like he sowed? Are you hearing this? And he did. We got to India and he had provided 500 projectors with 500 schools of ministry for the 500 pastors that brought their congregations to get under a tent that set about 8,000. And when we pulled up there at the airport, the police pulled up and they arrested Dr. Cerullo. For the year before, Dr. Cerullo had been in that same place and he had preached the gospel, and a person that had been totally blind from birth got their sight back in one moment. There was such a throng of people that rushed the stage to get prayed for. We all feared for Dr. Cerullo's life. And they thrust him and your mother, Susan, they thrust them away and they got them out of there and their lives were spared. but somebody stamped his passport as an insurrectionist. And so Dr. Cerullo said to me, he said, Larry, you go conduct the meeting because they don't know you here, but they know Dr. Cerullo. So you go ahead and go conduct the meeting. So for 5 days, it was 100 degrees outside and it was 125 degrees under the tent. Dr. Cerullo provided food for everyone. They all slept on the grounds. He gave out all these projectors with all these schools of ministry, all coming out of the benevolence of the ministry that you represent here tonight. Finally, the vice president of the nation of India found out Dr. Cerullo was in prison. They went and got him out of jail, and he got there 2 days before the conference was over. You should have seen those people shout when Dr. Cerullo walked in the building, walked in that tent. Oh, my, we nearly didn't get them back. It was such a great hour, but that wasn't the height of the story. This is one of those little-known things that we that were privileged to walk with him through those days, I want to share with you. When we got back to the airport to come back home, all of the people that were his jailers and the people that had locked him up for those 5 days, they all came running and kissing Dr. Cerullo's feet. And he one at a time picked them up and said, oh no, and he called them by name, one at a time. The next one and the next one. What had happened while he was in jail? He had led every one of his jailers to Jesus. Somebody help me, praise God. Right where you are, you need to stand up on your feet and say, Lord, make me a man like that. Make me a man like that. I saw it all over the world. We would walk late at night after the meeting. Listen, we would walk after the meeting late at night. He'd say, come on, Larry, let's take a walk. And he'd walk 20 feet and he'd stop and say, souls, Jesus, souls. And he would weep. And those who sow in tears, what? They reap with joy. And I saw such supernatural anointing move that I said, Lord, I'll never move away from my great love for Dr. Morris Cerullo and his wife and his precious family. And I do love you. And I do love all of you that are part of this great family. How many of you believe that because Dr. Cerullo knew how to sow, he also knew how to reap? Amen. And can I tell you, the reaping that's coming through this Legacy Center has just begun. I saw things with my eyes today I didn't know I would ever see again. But the multiplication of Morris Cerullo Ministries is going to be far greater in the future than it ever was in the past. Oh, go ahead and clap your hands. I know I'm right. I have a rare privilege tonight to stand before you and to ask you to pray, listen, and obey concerning a love offering that will not just promote, but will propel this ministry into her future. There's so much more that Greg and all the workers here are about to do. But I saw so much today, I said, oh Lord, I'm going to be a part of this. How many believe that if you ask the Holy Spirit what you should give tonight, he would speak to your heart about it? How many believe this is worthy of a worthy offering tonight? God bless you tonight. The Bible says, I would that men and women everywhere lift holy hands to God without wrath and without doubting. Lift both your hands to the Lord for a moment. And say these words after me. Thank you, Lord, for the revelation that brought this place into existence. The seeds that were sown. And you know me, Lord. You know the desires of my heart. And I want to sow tonight that I might reap my reward according to your perfect will. So I'm going to listen to you, Lord, and I'm going to sow what you tell me to sow tonight. Lift those hands and listen to the Lord. Lord, thank you for people hearing God tonight. For as surely as you spoke then, you're speaking now. And you will be speaking tomorrow. But you're praying for us right now that nobody would miss this moment of sowing into the kingdom of God through this incredible legacy world outreach center. Father, thank you. How many of you will wave your hands at me and say, I'll do what the Holy Spirit's telling me to do right now? Go ahead and just wave your hands. I'll do it. I'm not going to be afraid. Amen. You may take your seat if you would, please. And I'm going to ask Greg to join me here on the platform. I don't know what the Lord told you to do, but if he told you to sow $100 or more, I was told that this afternoon that you would receive a Bible like this. Am I right? A Bible like this. It's a prayer study Bible that has all of Dr. Cerullo's notes in the Bible. I don't know if you've ever seen anything like it, but you'll never see anything like it again. It's because I looked through it this afternoon with a critical eye, and I saw amazing. Everybody here needs one. And so I challenge you in Jesus' name, so that you might reap. And I saw this, and I don't know if you've mentioned it, but everyone, where's the book? Is this the one right here? Oh, yes. Here we go, Greg.
What I love about this. So this is a gift we want everybody to have tonight, regardless of what you give. These yellow stickies are Dr. Cerullo's notes, and he loved this. It's called A New Level of Strategic Spiritual Warfare Prayer, and he absolutely wanted every one of our partners to have a copy of this book. This was the message that you saw earlier in the service. This was the conference, and I love this. And so anyway, this is just a special gift we're going to give to everybody, regardless of what you sow. If you sow the $100, you'll receive, or more, the prayer Bible. This is Dr. Cerullo's prayer study notes from 7 decades of ministry, from Genesis to Revelation. Plus, you'll also receive the strategic warfare prayer, incredible revelation. Did anybody get something from the Word of God tonight? Somebody tell Dr. Larry Lee that you were blessed. And I want to ask our ushers if you'll help us. Let's get everybody an offering envelope. And you can use the QR code on the screen. And you can also text your gift to 858-281-4455. We want to give you just about 2 or 3 minutes to prepare your giving. You're absolutely right. This is part of our worship tonight. This is part of our prayer. You know, the Bible says that he said, prove me and see if I will not pour out a blessing upon you that you have not room enough to contain, and rebuke the devourer for your sake. You talk about spiritual warfare prayer. You talk about rebuking the devourer, the Lord rebuking the devourer. That's what he uses our giving. Giving is an incredible spiritual warfare weapon. So you believe God tonight for the anointing that you're sowing into. You'll receive that anointing. You'll receive that double portion. And so we want to just give you a few moments. If you're writing a check, make it payable to MCWE. You can use the QR code. You can text your gift to 858-281-4455. We're going to give everybody just a few moments. I want to tell Dr. Larry Lee one more time. Come on, tell him that you appreciate him coming, and what a word tonight. And this is just the beginning. Tomorrow is going to be an incredible day. Those of you that are going to be coming to the breakfast, I want to encourage you to get here by about 7:30, 7:45, because we will begin a little before 8 o'clock, and we're not really here for breakfast tomorrow because we're only going to take about 30 minutes to eat together, and we'll be in the Fountains restaurant. The Fountains is in this building. And it is the coffee shop. It's the restaurant here in this building, not in the hotel, but right here. And then we'll go from Fountains to the Western Wall, where Dr. Larry Lee is going to pray with us through the Lord's Prayer. Then we're going to come right from there into the auditorium. Bishop Clarence McClendon, Pastor Al Valdez, Brian, and all of the team. I tell you what, it's going to be a download tomorrow. And then we'll take a little bit of a break, and then Prophetess Sarah Morgan, Pastor Brian Bolt, and then the closing anointing and impartation service. It'll be all gone tomorrow night. Sunday morning, you're going to wake up and say, what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. We'll never be the same again. If you believe it, say amen. All right, if your offering is ready, just say I'm ready. All right, if you need more time and you're not ready, say not ready. Wow. All right, you all get ready. Larry, they must be listening. They're still listening. I tell you, I love that story. The first miracle Jesus ever did was a miracle of multiplication. And, you know, these stewards of the wedding, they came to Mary and they said, hey, could you ask your son to do a little magic trick for us? I want you to know something, that miracles are not magic, but miracles happen when we engage with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I love what Mary did. Mary went to Jesus and said, these guys want you to do this. And Jesus said, woman, this is not my problem. And if I was her, I would have went back to these guys and just said, you know what? I asked him, but he said, this is not my problem. But she understood something about her son. She understood he wanted to be engaged. And so she told them, whatever he says, do it. And that's what Larry's talking about tonight. And so they got an instruction from Jesus, and they filled those water pots, and they had the most incredible overflow miracle. It was the first miracle that Jesus ever did, and it was because they obeyed an instruction. And so we thank God tonight for everyone that is obeying him. And Lord, we just give you praise, Lord, for this word tonight. We give you praise. We thank you, Lord, for the giving of your people tonight. Lord, bless them, pressed down, shaken together, and running over in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen and amen. All right, ushers, go ahead and receive the offering. We're going to close in just a moment. I'm going to ask Pastor Brian Bolt, and I'm going to ask Prophetess Sarah Morgan to come and just close us and just pray a blessing over us tonight. So you just kind of hold steady, bring your giving. Brian, Pastor Brian, let's sing something that will just thank God.
Your voice.
Yes, Lord, your voice.
You have led me through the fire, darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. Oh, I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. So good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running. Running after me with my life laid down, surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. Let's put those hands together one more time for Papa Larry Lee. Okay, that hand clap is real jealous. I said, let's put our hands together for this great general. Amen. Thank you so much, Papa Lee, for just sharing that word with us. A timeless word, hallelujah, that will live for generations yet unborn. I'm just here to just say thank you so much, Greg, for having me. But this is my heart. This is my passion. And we're on a journey. We're on a journey. We just started to ascend. We've come to the mountain of prayer. And we're going to start ascending. And as we ascend, we are going to culminate in the presence of God as never before. I was taught many years ago that the church was not born in a committee meeting or a board meeting, but the church was born in a prayer meeting. It was born in a prayer meeting where 120 people gathered and raised a human altar and sacrificed for 10 days, and the fire of God fell. And that was the birthing of the New Testament church. Nothing has ever changed. The legacy of prayer will never ever die. When the disciples asked Jesus, "Teach us to pray," they said these words, "As John taught his disciples," which means John maintained the legacy of prayer because he understood that he was a product of prayer. His father and mother prayed for him, and because they prayed, God answered their prayer. And I came to prophesy to 10 of you, 20 of you, that as we ascend on this journey, this weekend, God will answer your prayers. Oh, I didn't get an amen. I said, God will answer your prayers. Amen. So pretty much what I'm going to be sharing tomorrow, I'm a little different because this is my papa. I caught the fire at a Morris Cerullo meeting all the way in London, and I was way up in the bleeper. And I'll never forget when Papa Larry Lee was releasing the fire of God. And I said, God, if that fire can reach me, let that fire reach me. And I promise you, I caught the fire. I caught the fire. Admission to London 30 years ago. And I remember when I met Papa Larry Lee here in the United States, the first words I said to him is that if you ever felt that your labor was in vain, I am the witness right here that what God used you to do has not gone in vain. I didn't get an amen. And that's why we're celebrating what Papa Morris Cerullo has done. He laid the foundation. Now it's our turn to continue to keep that fire burning. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm a little different because I'm from the jungles of Africa. And I come from the land of the lions. So tomorrow, I am coming to ignite the generators. There are generators that need to be ignited. Because God has called you to generate power. Your prayer generates power. And your prayer distributes power. The church will no longer be powerless. Because the generators are going to be reignited. God bless you. God keep you. God cause his face to shine upon you. And God be gracious unto you and give you peace, shalom. And I will see you right here tomorrow, and get ready for the fire.
Amen. Come on, let's all stand to our feet. How many know shouting is the language of victory? Let me say it again. Shouting is the language of victory. I'm going to say it one more time because my Jesus is not dead. Shouting is the language of victory. Muhammad is dead. Buddha is dead. But Jesus is alive. Tomorrow, we will pray for miracles. I want you to bring the sick. I want you to bring the hurting. I want you to bring the broken. And we will teach you how to pray for miracles. There have been more miracles this year happening around the world than I've ever seen before. Revival is popping up all over this world for the glory of God. If you believe that, give Jesus a shout of praise. And this is what I believe. Revival's coming to San Diego. Revival's coming to LA. Revival's coming to Southern California. I believe the best is yet to come. I believe Jesus is, he is alive. And if you believe that, give him a shout. Come on, Judah, let me hear your war cry. Woo. We're walking in a season like never before. I believe that you are going to see more miracles, signs, and wonders than ever before. I believe blind eyes are getting ready to open in the name of Jesus. Deaf ears, the mute are going to speak. The lame's going to walk. Not because of you, but who lives in you. Greater is he that lives in you than he that lives in. Shouting is the language of victory.
Well, somebody shout hallelujah. Well, we love you guys so much, and we want to just encourage you, enjoy the campus, go to the Western Wall. You can put your prayer requests on the wall, bring your prayer requests, put them in the prayer request box here on the platform tonight. Tomorrow, we're going to believe God, not only to teach us to pray, but to answer prayer with great and mighty deeds that we may have never known before. Don't miss tomorrow morning. Don't miss tomorrow afternoon. Don't miss tomorrow night. We just are going to camp out at Legacy and say, Lord, teach us to pray. And Lord, show us great and mighty things that we know not of. Don't forget, stop at the desk. Get the download of Dr. Cerullo's book. It's free. All of Dr. Cerullo's books on prayer are 50% off, and they're on the tables, and so you should take advantage of that. Teresa's restaurant is open until 10 o'clock tonight. They're serving kind of a lighter menu, hamburgers, sandwiches, those types of things. So if you want to grab something, grab a cup of coffee. Teresa's